Hello and welcome to another episode of Quest4Truth. I'm your host, Doug Hamp, co-host Rob Skiba. We're glad to be back with you.
Yeah. Let's go.
Okay.
Well, this is episode 23, right?
Yeah, I know. We're so excited. We're still cruising through this book. Well, let's not lose any momentum. Last time we left off in verse 8, we are now starting in verse 9. And this is the fifth seal. Now, Rob, just to remind people, we took a look at what a sealed scroll looks like. And it's impossible to open the scroll until all the seals are broken. So important. It's not like you kind of open this thing and then you break another seal and you open it a bit more and you break another seal. That's not what we're talking about. You know, it has nothing to do with that. You cannot open the scroll until they're all broken. And what I see happening is that when they're all broken, then it's over. You know, then we have what in Revelation chapter 11 it says, now the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. That, you know, this is it. So what we're seeing in the seals is a grand overview. This is the bird's eye view of the tribulation. And as we get into the trumpets and the bowls, those are going to be the down and dirty details of what happens. But here it's just a bird's eye view of what's happening throughout the latter half of the 7-year period, which we call the time of Jacob's trouble. So verse 9, I'll go ahead and read that. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. Wow, what's going on here? What do you think, Rob?
I've always been really intrigued with this because this almost seems like there's like a holding tank or something there. All these people hanging out under the altar.
Yes.
I don't really know what to make of that. I mean, it's kind of a bizarre image, at least in my head it is anyway, of what's going on there. Some people, might think the rapture has already taken place if they're going with the chronological view of things here, but I definitely agree with what you're saying, and I love the picture that we'll show that again, but the picture of the scroll with the seven seals preventing it from being opened. So until you get all of those seven off, you can't see what's really going on there. At this point, this fifth seal is broken. It says, and then John saw. It doesn't say he read. It says he saw the altar of the souls, that have been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. So it would seem to me that that's everybody, at least up to this point, who has been martyred for the faith or under there. And they're like, how long? How long are we going to have to, how long is this going to continue? And
right.
It says, it's kind of interesting what he says, because he says that's going to continue until the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. So, I mean, there's still people being martyred, and presumably these are believers. And so that being the case, again, the whole pre-trib view, it's like, okay, the church is taken out, presumably with the Holy Spirit, because that's who they believe the restrainer is, the pre-trib camp. And I was like, well, if the Holy Spirit leaves with the church, how do people get saved? Because you can't get saved without the Holy Spirit. So how does that work? And they're saying, well, these are those Jews, unfortunately they're left behind, and God's a wife beater, so he's beating up his wife, and somehow they end up getting saved, and meanwhile those who do get saved in the tribulation are going to get martyred, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that whole paradigm just doesn't work for me anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, again, if we don't have to have this in the context of, only the time of Jacob's trouble. If this could happen any time before that, right? He says that the souls of those who have been slain for the word of God and for the testimony that they held. Well, you know, let's go back to Revelation chapter 3. He talks about Antipas, right? I mean, there Jesus is totally bragging on Antipas. He's like, hey, and my faithful servant, you know, Antipas, who was martyred. You know, Antipas was probably, as far as we can tell, he was probably baked to death. The poor guy. And what an awful way to go. All right, so what, does he not get, you know, is he not one of these people that has suffered in an incredible way? You know, and of course, another question we have to ask is if to die is to be present with the Lord, and yet we don't have our new bodies until the resurrection. You know, I've heard that, well, you know, you kind of like, you pass through the veil and everything's like this weird time warp kind of thing. I think that's a bunch of baloney, quite frankly. You know, there's still time on the other side of the veil, all right? And Scripture proves that. And Scripture completely proves that. If you go to Revelation 22, you see that there is a tree of life, and it gives fruit every month, all right? So, you know, you go to Isaiah chapter 66, and it says that from one Sabbath to another, from one new moon to another, all flesh will come before the Lord. So you know, this whole idea that there's no more time, and that's just complete nonsense. I don't know where we got that idea. But time is simply the measure of change. That's all it is. And as temporal beings, we're always going to be changing. I mean, even in eternity, we will be learning. We will be growing, not wider or taller, but we will be growing in wisdom. We'll be growing in our understanding of this one that we love, God, of course. So, you know, it's not like we're all going to get there at the same time or some weird thing like that. I've heard these different theories, and I think they're completely out to lunch. So here you have these souls of people, and what I would argue is that, you know, if you die today, you're going to go and be in the Lord's presence, but you will not have your new body. You won't be out playing golf, you know, on the wonderful greens of the New Jerusalem. You're not enjoying your mansion just yet. I think everybody who has died up until this point is stuffed under that altar. And we need to understand, where is this altar? Well, if we go back to Isaiah chapter 6, we see in Isaiah 6 that Isaiah sees the Lord high and lifted up, and that there's an altar there. We, as we go through the book of Revelation, we see that there is a temple of God in heaven. In other words, the New Jerusalem. There is a temple in the New Jerusalem that is currently there. And then when John sees the New Jerusalem in Revelation 21, he says, and I saw no temple, for the Lord and Christ are the temple. And so there currently is a temple, but there will no longer be a temple. So the temple in heaven, which is where Jesus took his blood and offered it upon that altar, this one right here, where these souls are now being stored underneath, that's the same altar that the angel took the coal and used to touch Isaiah's lips, the same altar that Jesus took his own blood and offered it there upon the altar. These souls are being stored underneath that altar. Now, before the cross of Jesus, before Jesus took his blood, there were no souls underneath that altar. Those souls were all down in this place called the bosom of Abraham. And when Jesus ascended, he took in his train all these captives with him, and he took them up to heaven. But I don't think they're just out floating out and about. I think they're actually all being, you know, guarded. They're being kept underneath this altar. And, you know, I suppose it must be a whole lot better than being in the other place, right? It must be better than just hanging out in Abraham's bosom, because it's still a good thing to be in the presence of the Lord. But it's not the complete fulfillment of getting your new body. And that's why they're saying, so, hey, Lord, how much longer, you know? When do we get our new bodies, you know? I mean, of course, they're not technically saying that here, but they're asking, well, how much longer, Lord, until you judge those who dwell on the earth? Why do they want him to judge those who dwell on the earth? Because then they can have the Earth back, and we get to have our new bodies at that point. And, you know, so, yeah, what you do with the rapture here actually does become a very critical thing. But if we understand that this doesn't have to be taking place in the context of the Great Tribulation or the time of Jacob's trouble, or the seven-year period, whatever you want to call it, you know, if this is something that's even, you know, before or whatever, then, you know, the rapture question becomes less important. And I really think that, you know, like my dad died some years ago, and I think he's under that altar. Now, he didn't die in a horrific way, but just by the fact that he you know, has the Word of God, and he had God's testimony. You know, again, he wasn't martyred, so I don't know if that would disqualify him, but I don't know where else he would possibly go. So that would be my take on that. And if we see this as a bird's eye view rather than, you know, just the beginning part of the tribulation, then this corresponds pretty well to what we have in Revelation chapter 7. Because in Revelation chapter 7, it says, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, these here are given a robe, a white robe, to each of them. So it's a parallel, right? It's a parallel of what happens in the next chapter. And it fits together in a much more cohesive kind of way.
Yeah, let me put something up here. I showed this in one of the previous shows that I put together a tribulation timeline. And as you see right here on the left here, I speculated that the fifth seal doesn't have, just like you just said, doesn't have to be in the seven-year tribulation period. That it very well could be opened out here in what I call the birth pains phase. I didn't see any reason that it would need to be within the 7-year tribulation period. So, and you know, how much longer? And you know, obviously, what's coming next is going to be very horrific, and there are going to be a lot more people who are going to be slain for the testimony of Yeshua. You know, I'm in chapter 7 here. Let me back up. So, yeah, I don't see any reason why we should say that that's part of the 7-year tribulation period. There's nothing in there that would seem to indicate that to me, anyway.
I mean, you and I are in agreement on that, and so we probably don't need to beat the dead horse. But you know, it's not.
Well,
of course,
I do have a question.
Go ahead.
Well, you know, I don't know why I think this way. Sometimes I guess watch too many movies, but for some reason, the movie Kung Fu Panda came to my head, where Panda has gone into the hall of whatever, and he sees the vase that has the souls of the mighty warriors, whatever. He ends up knocking it over, and they're all like, oh, you know, on the floor. But he's talking to this vase that has all the souls of the mighty warriors in it. I mean, is that sort of, I know it's messed up, but is that sort of what we're talking about here? I mean, is this like a well of souls? Is this just like a, you know, it's hard to wrap your head around it, all these people stuffed under an altar, but
yeah. a step back. You know, in Corrupting the Image, I talk about how information is really the bridge that helps us to understand the connection between the physical earthly realm and the spiritual realm. And, you know, when you think about information, it's not something you can touch. It's not something you can hold, right? You can't see it, but it certainly exists. And I would argue that embedded in our DNA is the information that we would call our soul, and that there's something about it. You know, it's just like, you know, if I send you an email, or if, let's say I send you a picture, okay, I can send that to you, you know, by text. I can send it to you by email. We can download that to, you know, any different kind of device. The device itself doesn't really matter. I think in our days of cloud computing, that might help us to understand that it doesn't really matter what device I'm using to look at that. Now, certainly, if I have a, you know, super duper fancy computer that can do all things, you're like, wow, this is really amazing, right? But if I have, you know, an old computer and it still is able to do it, but, you know, it's a little bit clunky and it's kind of slow, well, you still get to see the picture, right? So it's not the device that matters so much. It's the data that we're manipulating. And I think when we're talking about the souls of men, we're essentially talking about their basic information packets. And these souls are wanting to have their new body because we know that they are going to be resurrected from the dust of the earth. They're going to get a brand new body. It's going to be angelic-like in nature. And it's going to be pretty amazing. I mean, it'll be like upgrading from, you know, some old machine in, you know, early 2000, you know, when you got the CRT monitor, you know, the big old clunky thing, and then finally you get the flat screen. You're like, wow, this is really cool. And if anybody can remember those old monitors, right? That was a major upgrade, right? So it's kind of like, hey, we want our upgrade. You know, we're just kind of like data sitting out there. And, you know, why should it be so impossible for us, especially in our modern age, to understand that people could be stored? You know, here it's called the altar. I mean, it certainly is an altar. But, you know, we're able to store an incredible amount of information on things we call servers, right? And, you know, it's impressive. But I think God's technology is so much more incredible because we looked at in chapter 5, the prayers of the saints are stored in golden bowls. Well, again, you know, a golden bowl is, it seems like it's very simple, right? How could you possibly store a prayer in a bowl? I mean, come on. Well, don't we do the same thing, right? I have all of my prayers, that is my requests, my emails. We don't call them prayers, right? But it's the same thing, right? It's just a message of some sort, a message being stored in some kind of a device. It's not a golden bowl, but, it's some little gizmo. And so here you have these people, their bare essence is, it doesn't really have a form, not a true form anyway, not a lasting form, let's maybe call it that, and they're being stored until the time that they get their new bodies. And then when they get their new bodies, then they're good to go. So they're really wanting to get that new body, and that's why I think this is so crucial that, that this doesn't have to be part of the tribulation, of the great tribulation. Now, it'll probably go through that. And certainly, you know, this is where we can no longer deny the question or the discussion of the rapture and the resurrection. Really, it's the resurrection that we should be talking about. The resurrection is the big event that we need to talk about. It's interesting that when Martha, you know, says to Jesus, hey, if you had been here, our brother would have died. He says, hey, you know, your brother's going to, you know, he's going to live again. She's like, I know. You're going to, you know, he's going to rise on the last day. Well, you know, Jesus doesn't say, no, it's not the last day. It's actually, you know, 7 years before the last day. He doesn't say that. He doesn't say anything, right? He just lets her go. And we know that the angel said to Daniel that you are going to sleep until the time of the end. And at that time, we have that for actually in verse 1, 12, Daniel 12, verse 1, at that time your people shall be delivered. That's clearly after the time of Jacob's trouble, right? First is the time of Jacob's trouble. Then comes the deliverance of the people of Jacob, right? And many of those who sleep in the dust shall awake. So here you have the resurrection happening after the time of Jacob's trouble, some to everlasting life and some to everlasting contempt. Unfortunately, you know, there aren't many good arguments for a pre-trib resurrection. Now, if we also go to Isaiah 26, you know, this is a pretty interesting passage, but in Isaiah 26, what we have there is probably the clearest Old Testament passage of the resurrection. Your dead body shall live. This is verse 19. Isaiah 26:19. Together with my dead body they shall arise. Awake and sing, you who dwell in the dust, for your dew is like the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead, the Rephaim. Come, my people, enter your chambers and shut your doors behind you. Hide yourself, as it were, for a little moment, until the indignation is past. For behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth will also disclose her blood and no more cover her slain. So here we have, there is some debate here, that first they rise, then they go and hide, and then the Lord comes out of his place. We don't know if that takes place over a couple years or a couple, weeks or days or hours. I mean, we're not told. That's, the basic thing. This could all happen in the day of the Lord, the day that Jesus comes back. I think that's incredibly likely this happens in a very short order, and so that, those who are not appointed to wrath, we're talking about the wrath of the Lord, the wrath that he's going to pour out the day that he comes back. That's the wrath of God, is the day that Jesus comes back. And so, the resurrection could very well take place on that day and not before. I only see evidence for one resurrection. Do you see any evidence for any more resurrections? I mean, obviously there's two. There's one for the bad people as well, but we're talking about the good one here. So what do you think?
Yeah, well, Revelation 20 seems to make it pretty clear that this is the first resurrection, and that's like at the end. When I read that, I'm going, well, how many resurrections are there? How many first resurrections are there? How many second comings are there? I believe there's one second coming and one first resurrection in Revelation 20. But I want to back up just a second, because as you were talking about the souls under the altar and data, I was thinking of, the devil's a great counterfeiter of everything that God does. And when you were describing that, it made me think, well, wow, the counterfeit to that is Ray Kurzweil's Singularity and this whole idea of uploading ourselves to a hive mind like the Borg, where we're all, all of our data is uploaded to a central computer, and we all are, in essence, the essence of our being is put into this computer, basically, where we all share the collective knowledge and wisdom of the entire planet. And Ray Kurzweil and the transhumanists and the 2045 Strategic Social Initiative, it just occurred to me as you were saying that, is the counterfeit of the souls under the altar.
2013 to 2014, new centers working on cybernetic technologies for the development of radical life extension rise. The race for immortality starts. 2015 to 2020, the Avatar is created, a robotic human copy controlled by thought via brain-computer interface. It becomes as popular as a car. In Russia and in the world appear, in testing mode, several breakthrough projects. Android robots to replace people in manufacturing tasks. Android robot servants for every home. Thought-controlled avatars to provide telepresence in any place of the world and abolish the need for business trips. Flying cars. Thought-driven mobile communications built into the body or sprayed onto the skin. 2020 to 2025. An autonomous system providing life support for the brain and allowing it interaction with the environment is created. The brain is transplanted into an Avatar B. With Avatar B, man receives new, expanded life. 2025. The new generation of avatars provides complete transmission of sensations from all five sensory robot organs to the operator. 2030 to 2035, ReBrain. The colossal project of brain reverse engineering is implemented. World science comes very close to understanding the principles of consciousness. 2035, the first successful attempt to transfer one's personality to an alternative carrier. The epoch of cybernetic immortality begins. 2040 to 2050. Bodies made of nanorobots that can take any shape arise alongside hologram bodies. 2045 to 2050. drastic changes in social structure and in scientific and technological development. All the prerequisites for space expansion are established. For the man of the future, war and violence are unacceptable. The main priority of his development is spiritual self-improvement. A new era dawns. The era of neo-humanity.
If what you're saying is true, that the essence of all the believers who have been martyred or have died, you know, like your father, and we all have relatives that are believers who have died, that their data is stored in the heavenly version of Singularity.
The heavenly hard drive.
You know, what we're seeing here on Earth. Yeah. Well, yeah, the heavenly hard drive. That what we're seeing here in the transhumanist movement is the counterfeit of that.
Yeah, you know, and all Satan can do is a counterfeit things. He doesn't have any original ideas, but he's an incredible counterfeiter. He does a pretty amazing job at it, in fact. And that's why I think the transhumanism 2045 thing, like you're saying, is so powerful. Because from beginning to end, you know, and that was really what I discovered in Corrupting the Image, is that I was like, oh my goodness, everything that the Lord wants to give us, which was made possible by the cross, Satan is going to counterfeit it, you know, either through, you know, demonism or high technology or some sort. And that's why it becomes so amazingly powerful.
Yeah, I was really quick trying to find the name of the movie. I can't think of it right now, but the Johnny Depp movie.
Oh, that was Transcendence. Transcendence.
Yeah, Transcendence. Yeah. That's exactly right.
Yeah, that was an amazing movie.
Right before he dies, it actually was. I mean, basically, it's kind of a remake of some other movies that have been out there. But before he dies, he's on the verge of some big breakthroughs and everything, and it's like, oh, it's a shame that this guy's got to die. Well, why don't we go ahead and practice some of the things that he's working on and just upload this guy's consciousness into the computer? And, of course, once he gets uploaded, he wants more power, and the more power he gets, you know, the more he's able to tap into everything in the world. And, you know, that really is, I think you're onto something there.
Good evening, Donald Buchanan.
It knows me.
Of course it's us.
Transcendence is the uploading of a human brain to a supercomputer. Every bit of activity in the human brain into a machine.
Intelligent machines will soon allow us to conquer our most intractable challenges.
The topics and some of the ideas that are, again, presented in the movie are definitely concepts that are being discussed seriously in academia.
Imagine a machine with a full range of human emotion. Its intelligence will be greater than every person born in the history of the world.
We can upload his consciousness.
Not like this.
As technology evolves, there becomes this natural push and pull between how much of it is good versus a bad thing.
But we shouldn't fear that if we can evolve ourselves spiritually.
Think about all the wonderful things that technology can do. Like you could save someone's life.
This is astounding.
Can you see me now?
I can.
Oh my God.
You're talking about immortality, and that is extraordinary.
Understanding consciousness and getting machines to be self-aware and so on, and for many people, the quest of immortality is naturally human.
Once something is available that will make us faster, better, stronger, it's very difficult for mankind not to go for it.
I need to expand, I need more power.
They don't know the danger.
I think what people like about films like this is that it's the not too distant future. This could be happening now or tomorrow.
It's really ultimately, I think, up to human beings to determine how far we let technology go and whether it ultimately helps us or hinders us.
The world isn't ready for this.
This is the future.
Technology should be used to further and to advance mankind.
What is this?
It's evolution.
If there's a way of correcting some of the things that we destroyed, that's what technology's best use is.
Where are you going?
Everywhere.
Transcendence, rated PG-13. Experience it in IMAX April 18th.
What we're seeing in Transcendence and the transhumanist movement, Ray Kurzweil, 2045 Strategic Social Initiative, is a counterfeit, an earthly counterfeit of what's happening with the heavenly data storage of going on under the altar.
Yeah, and I think it could be so amazingly attractive to us because it is a counterfeit of the real thing. And that's why I think it's important for us to kind of talk about these things, because what happens is we think of heaven, we think about, you know, eternal life and the resurrection and these really religious kind of boring sort of terms, you know, like we're going to be resurrected, then we're just going to be, you know, just kind of, we got our harp, we're on our cloud, and we're just kind of sitting there singing for the rest of eternity, ho-hum, boring, boring, boring. You know, but it's not that way at all. I mean, if you want to think about technology, God is the ultimate technologist, right? I mean, he's the ultimate high-tech kind of guy. In fact, he's so high-tech, he makes our high technology look like garbage. I mean, he's just yawning. He's like, gee, is that the best you got? You know, even a 1,000 years from now, he'd still be yawning. He'd be like, oh, boy, that's boring. I can do a whole lot better than that. You know, in fact, my stuff is so high-tech, it doesn't even look high-tech. You know, that's how amazing it is. And yet, I think the high-tech world that we are now in, you know, it is impressive, but I think it's now given us a window into understanding, you know, at a more detailed level, we can understand how some of these things are kind of working, because Satan, what is his motto? As above, so below, right? Why do you think he keeps saying that? You know, he does this whole thing, right? As above, so below, because he's like, well, gee, if I'm going to copy somebody, who should I copy? Well, why not copy God, right? God has all the cool ideas. God figured it all out. I'm just going to copy it and make my own version of that, right? It's kind of reverse engineering to the best he can of what God has already done. You got to give him some credit for that. I mean, you might as well reverse engineer from a master.
Well, yeah, that's really even the Genesis 6 experiment. If he had any idea that just himself in the sun through a human woman, then, you know, he's sort of preempting all of that, because, you know, the first prophecy of Genesis 3:15, that Eve's seed is going to crush the devil's head, you know, and there's this whole seed war that's going to take place between his offspring and the seed of Eve. And, you know, if he got some idea in his head that, wait a minute, you know, seed of Eve, if it's going to crush my head, you know, is God going to have a son through humans or, you know, whatever? It does appear that that was his, you know, Genesis 6, he's like, okay, let's give this a shot on our end. If the spiritual can mate with the physical and produce offspring, well, let's go ahead and give this thing a try. And the ABC did a series called, I think it was called The Fallen. And in this show, they release Azazel, and he's depicted as sort of this Rico Suave kind of guy, you know. And he's in the car, and he's driving with this other guy who's a Nephilim, I guess, or whatever, kid. And they're down the road, and Jesus saves or something like that. And he, you know, he had seen other things about this Jesus guy, so he asked him, you know, who is this Jesus? And
so who is this Jesus character anyway? Seriously, I've been seeing his name everywhere.
Well, a lot of people think that he was the Son of God. That's so funny.
The Creator had a kid. Well, do as I say, not as I do, eh?
Did you seriously not know that?
Been out of the picture for a while.
You know, he's kind of lamenting. He's like, well, what the heck, you know? You can do it, I can't do it. You know, I'm in jail for 5 years, but you do it, and you get this son, Jesus, you know? And I'm going, huh. You know, it was an interesting line, the way they depicted that in the movie, you know, do as I say, not as I do, huh? Yeah, I mean, he's always trying to counterfeit. And so that makes perfect sense to me, that that's exactly what's going on with this transhumanist movement, as above, so below.
Right, yeah. And it's just interesting. So here in the fifth seal, these people that do not have a body, You know, and what they look like, we don't know. I mean, in the kind of a ghostly, I think kind of a ghostly, wispy kind of existence is what I would imagine. You know, it's probably, you know, you can kind of see the facsimile of the person, but you can't, but they're not like, you know, something that's really tangible, as it were, as far as I can tell. But, you know, they're waiting. You know, they're
just
waiting.
Just like Kung Fu Panda.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. You know, it's not that. It's not that these other people don't see some truths. They do get bits of it here and there. But, you know, the Bible, as we kind of just take these things and chew on them, really help us to get a better grasp on it. And again, I would argue that this is, from the bird's eye view, it's the, you know, the 30,000-foot perspective, and it corresponds with Revelation 7, Revelation 14, and also the resurrection to a greater or lesser extent. And now here we come to verse 12, the sixth seal. I mean, this is, in my opinion, this is where we have the real action. You know, this is the real action. And here we're definitely in the time of Jacob's trouble. And again, I wouldn't say that it has to be exactly at this time or exactly at that time, but I say it's a general, again, bird's eye view of the events that will happen in the time of Jacob's trouble. It says, when I looked when he opened the sixth seal. Remember, the scroll hasn't been opened yet. We're just opening the seals. And behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon like blood. Now, I just want to stop right there. Well, actually, I'll go on just a little bit more. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. All right, so here we have the sixth seal. When he opens this thing, what he sees is a great earthquake, the sun becomes black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon becomes like blood. All right. And the stars of heaven fall to the earth at this point. Where else do we see this in the book of Revelation? Well, we see it a few places. The most obvious the place where you really can't argue is in Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. Then another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having seven heads and ten horns and seven diadems on his heads. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. Now, if we're in any doubt as to what that means, go to verse 9, Revelation 12, 9. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan. Okay, we're talking about Satan. Satan's he's the dragon. And he cast to the earth, and he was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So stars and angels are one and the same thing in the book of Revelation. In other words, when it talks about stars, it's talking about angels. It's very important. We see in Revelation chapter 1, it says that Jesus is holding the seven stars in his right hand, which are the seven angels to the seven churches. The stars are angels. So when we come to Revelation chapter 6, right there we have a very powerful description of these stars being cast down to the earth. Now I also want to go to Revelation chapter 8. Because in Revelation chapter 8, starting at verse 10, it says, then a third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch. So let's think for a second. This, the dragon takes with his tail a third of the stars, that is the angels, and they're all cast to the earth. And then here in Revelation 8:10, it says, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch. The name of the star is Wormwood. As we continue on with this, we're going to see in Revelation chapter 9, he says, and I saw a star fallen from heaven to the earth, and to him was given the key to the bottomless pit. And then later we're told that the name of this star, this one that has fallen to the earth, his name is Abaddon, or in Greek it's Apollyon. It's the destroyer. Well, who could this possibly be? Who would be the great star? Well, it would be Satan himself. And who would be the lesser stars? Well, those would be the demons. So when we get to Revelation chapter 6, And it says, I saw the stars of heaven fall to the earth. We're not talking about comets or meteorites or something falling to planet Earth and, you know, sort of doing a deep impact kind of idea. We're talking about the angels of heaven, the fallen angels, the bad angels, are now being cast to the earth. And when does this happen? Well, in Revelation chapter 9, it says that when he opened the abyss, that smoke came out. In fact, there's so much smoke. Verse 2, and he opened the bottomless pit, and smoke arose out of the pit like the smoke of a great furnace. So the sun and the air were darkened because of the smoke of the pit. So right there we have it. This is, again, why the book of Revelation should not be taken chronologically, but it should be taken thematically, because here you have this smoke coming out of the pit. So this happens at the beginning of Jacob's trouble. So this is the 3.5-year mark. This is when this pit is opened. A tremendous amount of smoke. You know, they say that, not if, but when the Yellowstone caldera goes off, that it's going to be like a nuclear winter. It's going to put out so much ash that it's going to cover all of North America, and that we will not be able to see the sky at that point, basically. You know, and I remember some years ago here in California, we had quite a few forest fires, and I looked up, I saw the moon, and it was blood red. I kind of got excited. I'm like, oh, cool, you know, maybe this is the Lord's return. Well, you know, he didn't come back. Because I realize, okay, when you see a blood red moon, this isn't talking about an eclipse, sorry, and it's not talking about, it's talking about the layer of ash that's going to be in the atmosphere. There'll be so much ash that you won't see the stars. And when you see the sun, it will look like it's covered with sackcloth. And when you look at the moon, it's going to be blood red. That is what happens. And we have pictorial evidence of this. I mean, just a couple years ago, 2011, in Iceland, there were, you know, a tremendous amount of ash came out of those volcanic eruptions. And the sun looked like it was covered with sackcloth, and the moon was blood red. So that is what's happening in Revelation 6, verse 13.
Yeah, I agree. Chris White did a debunkumentary on the whole tetrads thing.
Yeah.
And I think he made a very compelling case. And that caused me to rethink it, too. I had previously not been 100% on the bandwagon, but I was on the tetrads thing, and it's why I produced 322 tetrads in the time of Jacob's trouble. But as I looked through the scriptures, the same ones that Chris White points out, for this one, for instance, when it talks about the moon turning blood red, it has nothing to do with an eclipse.
Right.
It has to do, in each of these cases, you see, you know, previous to that statement of a blood red moon, you see smoke and fire. It's also in, I believe it's written very similar in Joel, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
But at any rate, when I looked at it, I'm like, well, this doesn't appear to have anything to do with eclipses. It has more to do with the smoke and ash, exactly what you were saying. So, you know, that's not to totally throw out the whole tetrad thing. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. I think the purpose for this tetrads happening on the Lord's feast days is to draw attention to the Lord's feast days.
Yes.
You know, people right now, Christians who never, they all thought it's the Feast of the Jews. I'm like, guys, you actually read the Bible? It doesn't say Feast of the Jews. Leviticus 23, 1 through 4, repeatedly. This is the Feast of Yahuwah, Yod Heh Vav Heh, Feast of the Lord. They're his feasts, not the feasts of the Jews, one tribe out of 12. They're the feasts of God. And, you know, kudos to Mark Biltz for discovering this and pointing it out and, you know, making it really popular for a lot of other people to write about it, talk about it. But now it's a global phenomenon where people who never paid attention to the feasts of the Lord are all of a sudden paying attention to them. And I think my personal opinion is that's the real purpose of the blood moons. Is to get people on God's page. We were talking off the air about sort of an after-action for all of our conferences. You know, when we talk about Nephilim and conspiracies and scary stuff, and you know, people are like, "Great, okay, I got all this information, but now what? You know, what do I do with this? You know, what are we supposed to do about it?" And for me, the last few years of doing conferences, my after action is like, "Look, guys, get on God's page. Nothing more important than that. Get on God's page." And part of getting on God's page is understanding the script that he's following. When you realize that the feasts are Moedim, they are appointed times, they are dates that he's got written out on his daily planner of all of humanity's time frame, where he says, "Hey, on these specific days, I've got things that are going to happen." And Yeshua is the main character. He knows his lines perfectly, and he hits his mark every time, and he hits them on the Moedim, on the appointed times that he has appointed for these things to take place. So for me, when I look at these blood moons happening on the Lord's feast days, I'm really excited, because now people who never paid any attention to that are all of a sudden paying attention to the Moedim. And I believe that this is a precursor, that it's a tech rehearsal. God is getting everybody globally to look at these appointed times and pay much more attention to them than they ever did before. And hopefully, as they're doing so, they might start thinking, "Hey, maybe we should kind of mikra these, rehearse these every year, that they are still important." And when you read Leviticus 23 and elsewhere where the feasts are talking about, God says these are perpetual, forever, everlasting. They're not ending at the cross, they are continuing, and indeed, as you go into the millennial reign, you're seeing them in the millennial reign as well. And Zechariah talks about, hey, if you don't show up for Sukkot, you know, it's not going to be good for you. So might as well start practicing them now, and you know, these blood moons are getting people to think about them. And as they're thinking about them, they're learning about the feast, and as they learn about the feast, they're seeing, wow, Yeshua is all over these things. He's all... Man, the feasts are all about him. And as soon as you realize that, it's not a bad deal to throw out Christmas and Easter, which have nothing to do with our Savior. You throw out two and you get eight. That's a good deal. You get the seven feasts plus the Sabbath, and all of these are about him. So it's a good deal. Throw out the two, get the eight. And as you get the eight and you realize not only are they amazing with full of revelation, but they're fun. They're exciting. They're exhilarating. You know, we're getting ready to do Sukkot in Texas. Sukkot, Texas is going to be awesome. Our whole group's going down there for this. And, of course, we'll all be looking for the blood moons and stuff because it'll be taking place during Sukkot. But we are starting the process. We actually started a couple years ago of Mikra, of rehearsing the Moedim. And as more and more people are doing that, I think more and more people will get on God's planner. And they'll be prepared, because it's to the foolish that he comes as a thief in the night. Everybody's like, "Oh, he's coming. We're not going to know when he's coming." Well, if you're saying we're not going to know when he comes, you don't understand what Paul's talking about. You know, it's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. He says, "But you, brethren, are not in darkness that they should overcome you as a thief." He starts off saying, "Of signs and seasons, I have no need to tell you." Why? Because they're already doing it. They already know the signs and the seasons, the Moedim. They're already practicing, rehearsing them. So he doesn't have to tell them that, because if you're doing that, then you know he's coming back on the Feast of Trumpets. And, you know, what Feast of Trumpets, we don't know. But on a Feast of Trumpets, he's coming back, so you might want to start getting used to hearing the sound of the shofar, because that's the clarion call you're going to hear. So, you know, that's the real purpose of the blood moons. But when we look prophetically at the blood moons, it has nothing to do with eclipses. It has to do with the smoke and fire, as we just see right here in Revelation chapter 6.
Yeah, well said, well said. Yeah, you know, so, you know, this is, I mean, I believe I'm taking this passage super literally. I think,
literally.
You know, I think I'm taking this very, very literally. And again, you know, when we have symbols, we always have to look for the key, right? There's always a key to a symbol. I mean, that is, you know, when you see sometimes on a piece of paper an asterisk next to a word, you say, well, I have to go and find, you know, down below, and it tells you, okay, this is what that actually means. And that's what we have here. So when we have the stars, we'll look through the book and see where it talks about stars, and we see that the stars are consistently called angels. You know, angels are called stars, we should say. So the stars of heaven falling to the earth, again, we're not talking about some meteorite shower, we're talking about angels mm-hmm. falling down on the planet Earth. And, you know, that is going to, you know, change things.
Yeah, Dr. Michael Bennett, Dr. Future, has a really good teaching on likening the figs with the angels also. So you got kind of a dual symbol going on. You got the stars falling, but you also got the figs falling. I apologize, I don't have an address to give people, but you could probably just look up Michael Bennett and his teaching on figs related to angels. It's pretty fascinating. So I definitely agree with you on that. That's what that's talking about there as well.
And in Isaiah 24:21, it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord will punish on high the host of exalted ones, and on the earth the kings of the earth. So again, we're talking about these fallen angels, that God is going to judge them in that day. But I think you're going to say we're about out of time, and that is true. We are out of time, and we're going to have to say adios. But very fun chapter. I'm loving this, and you know, this is the kind of stuff that we're going to continue to do as we go through the book of Revelation. So until next time, everyone, may the Lord bless you. Keep on your quest for truth, not for doctrine, not for dogma, not for church tradition, for truth, because only reality matters. Nothing else matters. Nothing that, you know, I or Rob or your favorite pastor says actually matters, unless it is based on reality, right? And the reality of the Word, and the Word has to be taken consistently. You know, we don't just say, well, over here it means this, but over here, there it means that. No, things are consistent in the Bible. That's what I love about it. It just somehow we've mucked it up. So until next time, anyway, God bless you all.